Hello guys, myself Pushpendu Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs. So today you have 28th of April 2021, and as you know that these lectures are basically useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC, right? And these lectures are basically based on the current affairs. For that you would be studying the national newspapers like The Hindu and Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. And you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube also, that is Future IAS, for these lectures. And you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. So you can enhance your preparation with the help of these lectures for UPSC Civil Services examination. Alright, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is related to world military spending. As you know that the world military spending is basically something that a particular country spend their finance or their money for the purpose of the military, you know, softwares, hardwares, or military purpose, you know, other arsenals. So it is basically a spending that has made by a particular country for the purpose of consolidating its military arsenals, right? So this year, the report which is published by the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, right, which says that this year, right, the total military expenditure, like when you compare with the global term, right, which rose to 1,981 billion, you know, dollars, you know, when you compare with the last year, that is basically 2.6% increase, right, in the real terms when you compare with 2019. So this year the military expenditure rose to $1,981 billion, right, when you compare with the last year figure. Okay, so this report have been published by the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, that is also called SIPRI. What is SIPRI? Let us understand in the brief. So Stockholm International Peace Research Institute is basically an international institute located in Stockholm. Okay, and it was founded in 1966, right? And it provides basically a data or analysis or some form of recommendations for the armed conflict, for the military expenditure, as well as the arms trade, right? As well as some data related to the armed control and the disarmament also. So this year, according to the report which is published by the Stockholm Research Institute, which says that this year the five biggest spenders for the military purpose are basically the United States of America, which is the largest spender, then followed by China, India, Russia, and the United Kingdom. These are the five major countries which have spent, right, which have spent around 62% of the global, you know, the expenditure in terms of the world military spending. All right. So these are the five biggest, you know, the spender in terms of the military expenditure. Okay. This is basically the report for year 2020. All right. And 2.6% increase that has been there. Basically, we are seeing that this year this has been recorded as a 2.6% increase, right, when the global domestic product is basically shrunk. So despite of the shrinking of the global gross domestic product, this military spending have been increasing. So that is, you know, one of the crucial report which have been given by the SIPRI. So even the GDP or gross global domestic product, which is shrunk by 4.4%, right, the world military spending has increased to 2.6% this year when you compare with 2019. This projection which was given by, you know, that world gross domestic product is basically shrunk by 4.4%. That projection was given by the International Monetary Fund. Okay. Obviously, the shrinking of this gross global domestic product is because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay. Now, let us understand also what is this International Monetary Fund here also. See, International Monetary Fund is an organization which is basically also called the International Financial Institution, which is headquartered in Washington DC. Okay, so it is an organization where around 190 countries basically participate. So the main purpose of the International Monetary Fund is to foster the global monetary cooperation okay, is to secure the financial stability, right? To facilitate international trade, right? And to promote, the high employment throughout the world, and to achieve the sustainable economic growth, and definitely to reduce the poverty around the world, right? So it is an international financial institution, right? The current managing director of IMF, as you already know, that is Kristalina Georgieva, okay? And it is headquartered at Washington, D.C. And the chief economist of International Monetary Fund is Geeta Gopinath, right? The Geeta Gopinath, who is also having the Indian origin descent, okay? So in 2020, the U.S. military basically reached an estimated around $778 US billion. So you can understand, the U.S. is the largest spender in terms of the world military spending, right? Which is representing, the largest expenditure which have been occurred in terms of the military, right? And in the U.S., if you talk about in the U.S. also, their expenditure for the military purpose have increased, right, of around 4.4% when you compare with the last year. That means the US have spent 4.4% more money for the military purpose this year, despite of having the pandemic. So US have already spent $778 billion for the purpose, right? And if you compare with the global share, the US account for around 39% of the total military expenditure in 2020. That means out of 100%, the US account for around 39% of the global military expenditure worldwide. All right. So here you can understand the world military expenditure by the region. So this basically figure is given by the SIPRI, right? So here there is vertical columns. So in the vertical columns, what you can understand is that the first darker one is called Middle East. The second lighter one is Europe. The further lighter one is Asia and the Oceania. Then Americas, and the last is basically Africa. Okay, so this is basically in terms of their military expenditure when you consider with constant 2019 the US billion dollars. So here you can understand, right, that the basically in the vertical column or in the vertical axis you can have the military expenditure in terms of the US billion dollars. You can read out this chart, right, with the help of this figure. All right. So let's understand the new news, that is the Dadudan Gadvi. The Dadudan Gadvi is basically a person who is also a Gujarati poet. So recently, the Dadudan Gadvi has died. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically, condoled for the demise of the Dadudan Gadvi, right, who was also the Gujarati poet. All right. So let us understand a brief, the background about the Dadudan Gadvi, right? The Gadvi was basically born in 1941, right? And he basically belongs to a Gir region of Gujarat, okay? And he basically returned the songs for the Gujarati film also. And his basic works for which he have been awarded, right? For various awards, like you have the Terwa, right? Then you have the Lachanayan, that is in 2015. So he was awarded for their works for this purpose. And the work called Terwa, consisting of the four volumes, right, for which he was also awarded. And the Gadvi was also awarded, right, the Padam Shri. He was awarded a Padam Shri in 2021 itself for his contribution in the literature and the education. Okay. And Gadvi was also awarded the Gujarat Gaurav Award. Okay. The Gujarat Gaurav Award. He was awarded for that, right? And as well as he was also awarded the Jawarchand Meghani Award for the purpose of his contribution in terms of the poetry in Gujarati. Okay, so he was basically a Kavi, he was also a folk singer, he was also a poet, and he has written, right, the elaborate, literature in terms of the Gujarati also, and he has also contributed in terms of, the songs specifically in the Gujarati films, and he was awarded a Padma Shri also. So he is basically the Dadudan Gadvi who was recently demised, right? And Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically expresses the condolence for his, on his demise. All right. So let's move to the new news, that is Article 223 of the Constitution. So first, let us understand what is Article 223 says about what? So first of all, the Article 223 basically deals with the appointment of Chief Justice. Okay, it is basically deals with the appointment of Chief Justice. Okay, now what is happening is that let's just get to the background. In the Calcutta High Court, right? The Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court is going to retire, right? So the President of India has the power to appoint a new judge as a Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court. So in that background, the President has appointed a new judge as a Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court under using the power of Article 223 of the Constitution. So let us understand what is 223 of the Constitution. So Article 223 very categorically says that when the office of the Chief Justice of a High Court is vacant, okay, is vacant, or when any such Chief Justice is by reason or by absence or by otherwise unable to perform the duties, right, of his office, right, such duties will be performed by, right, such other member of a court as the President may appoint for the purpose. So it is the power given to the President of India for the appointment of the Chief Justice of a concerned High Court if the office for the Chief Justice of India is vacant or he is otherwise not able to perform his duties of the office, then President of India may appoint any other judge as the Chief Justice of India, right? Chief Justice of High Court, sorry, for the purpose of discharging the duties of the Chief Justice of a concerned High Court. All right. So here in that using of that power, Article 23, the President of India basically conferred this power, has appointed Justice Rajesh Bindal, right, who is also the most senior most judges of among the judges of Calcutta High Court, have been recently been appointed as a Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court to perform the office, to perform the duties of the Chief Justice of a Calcutta High Court from 29th of April 2021. Okay, now let us understand a brief background about basically Justice Tuthal Bhaskaran Nair, who is going to retire. Okay, so here what is there is that the justice basically is going to retire, right, and the new judge Justice Rajesh Bindal is going to be appointed, right? So here the President Ramnath Kovind has appointed Justice Rajesh Bindal as a acting Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court. So he will be succeeding the Chief Justice, that is the Tothil Bhaskaran Nair Radhakrishnan, right? He is basically set to retire on 29th of this month. So from 29th of this month, right, the new Justice Rajesh Bindal will be appointed as a Chief Justice of the Calcutta High Court. All right. So here I have already explained you Article 223. So I hope you would have understood the Article 23. The power vested with the appointment of the Chief Justice of a concerned High Court, right, goes to the President of our country. So President of our country is basically has the power to appoint a judge of a high court as a Chief Justice of the High Court, right, if there is a vacancy in the office or by some reason the Chief Justice of a concerned High Court is unable to perform the duties, right, the President can appoint such other judge as a basically Chief Justice of a concerned High Court. All right, so here you can see in the background that is basically the High Court of Calcutta. All right, next let us understand Supply Chain Resilience Initiative. So let us understand what is Supply Chain Resilience Initiative, then we'll move to the news. Okay, so first of all let us go a brief background. Now you know that in the supply chain in the sphere, right, the China is basically dominant player, specifically in the Indian region as well as in the Pacific region. When you compare with India, Japan, Australia, this region I'm talking about, okay, so the China is basically a dominant player. Now the India is heavily dependent on the China, right? Even the Australia and the Japan is also influenced by the Chinese initiative. Now what is happening is that even there are many such instances like COVID-19 or any such instances like natural disaster, the China is basically is the dominant player in this region. So definitely there is also one more background is that there is also a trade tensions between China and the United States of America, right? That is basically threatened the supply chains in this region, in the Indian Ocean region as well as in the Pacific Ocean region. So what happens is that the Japan, right, who is also the neighbor of China, has mooted the supply chain resilience initiative. So it is mooted by the Japan, that is known as supply chain resilience initiative, right, as a trilateral approach. It is a trilateral approach with India and Australia, right? So it is mooted by, right, mooted by Japan. Okay, it is basically a trilateral approach, okay, that involve the three countries, that is Japan, Australia and India. Okay, so here, for the purpose of the having the resilience in the supply chain, this initiative was basically launched. So first of all, I told you that there is a context that in the international trade, the supply chain is very basically very important, right, which helps the country to ensure that it has the diversified in terms of the supply risk across the clutches of the supplying nation, where the China is having the dominant player, right? And in any unanticipated events like that may happen because of corona or because of, say, any sort of a natural disaster like tsunami or earthquake, right? Or even in any pandemic, right? Such armed conflict also can occur in that region. So there will be definitely a disruption in the supplies in a particular country, right? So in the event of the disruption of the supplies, what will happen? There will be a halt in the trade. There will be a halt in the trade and could adversely affecting the economic activities of a destination countries as well as the economic activities of a origin countries. To have the resilience in the supply chain, this initiative was basically launched. So the ultimate objective of this initiative is basically to cut down the dependency on a single region or single nation, that is China currently. So these three countries are basically planning to cut down the dependency on the China for that purpose, that is for sure. Okay, and as this is basically the other objectives of this initiative, definitely to attract the foreign direct investment, definitely specifically in the Indo-Pacific region, to make the Indo-Pacific region as an economic powerhouse. Okay, then to build a mutually complementary relationship among the other partners, say India, Japan and Australia, right, as well as with other partners like US or other Western developed countries, right, and to definitely to build and plan for a supply chain network that is most vibrant, most resilient, even in the time of any emergencies or any exigencies, right? So possible policy measure that could take by these three countries, India, Japan and Australia, that would be supporting, the enhanced utilization of the digital technology, supporting the trade, investment, diversification, foreign direct investment, right, for the purpose of this supply chain, right? So here what is happening is that I have given you the brief background about that one. So definitely the main purpose to reduce the dependence of the China. Okay, so the supply chain resilience initiative is to create the virtuous cycle of enhancing the supply chain, right, to attract the strong, sustainable and balanced inclusive growth in the region, that is the Indo-Pacific region. Okay, and it is based on the consensus between the three countries, right, that will be taken in the due course of the time. So here you can see the India, right, you have the Japan and you have Australia. So you have basically a trilateral initiative, right, that is in the form of this. Okay, next, the large area certification scheme. Okay, so first of all, let us understand this scheme, then we move to the news. Okay, so what is this large area certification scheme? So first of all, let us go a brief background. Okay, in short, you can say this scheme is basically LAC, that is large area certification, LAC scheme. Okay, so what is that LAC scheme? So you must understand, despite of having the India basically had made a strong roads in the agricultural practices, in the modern agricultural practices, but there are still some regions like the tribal areas, deserts, the low rainfall areas, hills, right? These areas are basically remains cut off from the modern agricultural practices, right? And these areas also remains free from the chemical input. That means, you have used, some sort of a synthetic fertilizers like the phosphorus, urea, right, phosphatic, right, all such chemical inputs or your pesticides, weedicides. These areas are basically remains cut off. I'm talking only in terms of the hilly areas, tribal areas, desert areas and rain fed areas that are basically some sort of a isolated areas, right? They remains cut off. Now what happens is, some traditional areas, right, with a little effort, such areas can be brought under organic certification. So the point is that the government of India is planning to put those areas. The areas are basically the hilly areas, I'm talking the tribal areas, okay, the desert areas and rainy areas, right, which are basically some sort of a isolated patches, right? These are basically remains cut off. So in order to incorporate these areas into the organic certification, as you know already, organic food, right? So organic certification, right? The government of India has basically, you know, have enacted this scheme. So here the Department of Agriculture, the Farmers Welfare, under their flagship scheme called Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. Already, you know, it is a basically scheme of the Department of Agriculture and the Farmers Welfare, right? It basically launched a large area certification program to harness the potential of these areas. I'm talking about the hilly areas, tribal areas, desert areas, and the some sort of a rainfall areas which are isolated, right? So here, as per the established norm, right, the main purpose is to incorporate those areas into organic certified areas, right? So there, the chemical input uses, right, which is basically, you know, required to undergo a transition period of minimum 2 to 3 years before they would be qualified as your organic certified areas. So, you know, in that areas, what the farmers used to do, the farmers used to adopt, right, the standard organic agricultural practices, right, if they want this area to be qualified to be incorporated into large area certification scheme. So what the farmers is required to do, they must require to have, right, certain standard organic agricultural practices, right, and in order to keep this certification process open for their farms, isn't that? And after successful completion of, say, you know, 2 to 3 years, they will be certified as your organic farm. They will be certified as an organic farm, and definitely this certification process would require an elaborate documentation and verification by the government agencies, right? So here, you know, all such documentation certification is basically a cost effective, and the farmers basically would be benefiting out of this organic certified farms, that they will be getting, you know, some revenues based on that, and that it will be based on the PGS organic certified products. What is the PGS organic certified product? That I will explain you in this slide after that. Okay, so here what happens is, under this program, 14,491 hectares of the Union Territory of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, right, have been become the first contiguous territory. Contiguous territory means it is a continuous territory to be conferred as your organic certified area under the large area certified scheme. So as I've given you basically the background of that one, so around 15,000 hectares of the area of the Union Territory of Andaman and Nicobar Islands have been qualified or have been certified under, you know, the large area certification scheme. So as I told you that it is basically a program of Department of Agriculture, Cooperation, the Farmers Welfare, definitely to identify those traditional organic areas to transform into a certified organic production hubs. Okay, now Government of India has already certified 14,491 hectares of such areas under the Andaman and Nicobar Island, that is the Union Territory, say precisely Kar Nicobar, which is island, as well as the North Pobre group of islands, which is basically the Union Territory of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So here the area becomes basically the large contiguous territory, right, which is a continuous territory, which will be conferred this large area certification scheme under the PGS India, that is a participatory guarantee scheme certification program. Now let us understand what is that participatory guarantee system certification program, under which this large area or large contiguous area of the Andaman and Nicobar Island have been certified as a large area certification scheme, right? So first of all, let us understand what is that participatory guarantee system. So first of all, let us understand that under any of this large area certification, the scheme, the each village of that area, for example, this 14,491, there may have many villages, right? So each villages in the area considered as a one cluster or one group, right? So documentation will be simple for that, and the documentation will have to be maintained on the village wise for the purpose, and all farmers who are basically belongs to this region, right, with their farmland, with their livestock, need to adhere to certain standard requirement, right, before getting verified for the large area certification program. And the certification will be based on the annual verification done by the Department of Agriculture, okay, by the process of, you know, the PGS India, that is Participatory Guarantee Certification Program. So what is that? So first of all, the Participatory Guarantee Certification Program is basically which ensured that the production takes place according to well laid standards, okay, And that standard will be definitely based on certain consensus, certain scientific criteria, right? So here, according to the participatory guarantee system, right, an operational manual for domestic organic certification published by the Department of Agriculture in 2015, right, that is by National Center of Organic Farming, that is basically set up in, or that is basically established in Ghaziabad. So National Center of Organic Farming has given the operational manual for domestic organic production certification scheme for the purpose of the participatory guarantee system for India. Okay, that is definitely under the Ministry of Agriculture and the Department of Agriculture and the Cooperation. So here, the PGS will ensure that a quality assurance initiative that will be taken place, and that will be locally relevant, and that will emphasize on the participation of the stakeholders, like the stakeholders in this process, maybe the producers, consumers, right? And definitely there will be also the third party verification, right? So all such involvement basically are called the participatory guarantee system, which are locally focused, where the quality assurance system that will certify the producers based on the active participation of the stakeholders. All stakeholders, that may be a consumer, that may be, you know, the producers, or maybe third party, right? So that will be built on a foundation of the trust, based on the social networks, and based on the knowledge exchange. So there will be four pillars of this participative guarantee system, that is the participatory approach, a shared vision, transparency, and the trust, on which this system is basically focused on. Okay, next, the Human Rights Watch, that is basically also known as HRW. So here what is happening is that the Human Rights Watch is basically an international non-governmental organization, as you already probably know. Okay, now what is happening is that the Human Rights Watch, which is an international non-governmental organization, is basically, in its report, says that the Israel is committing a crime of apartheid. The crime of apartheid, right? So it has basically put the country called Israel, right, which is committing the crime of apartheid, right, by seeking the maintaining of the Jewish domination over the Palestinians. As you know that there is a Israel and Palestinian conflict in this region, right? So the Israel is basically committing the crime of apartheid in this region, right, by maintaining the dominance and the superiority of the Jewish people over and above the Palestinians and its own Arab population. It has been claimed by the international non-governmental organization, which is also known as the Human Rights Watch. The Human Rights Watch is basically headquartered in New York City, and it is basically conducting the research and the advocacy specifically in the human rights issues. Okay, so this Human Rights Watch basically pressurize the governments, policy makers, companies, and individual human persons, right, who basically abuses certain humans based on certain predefined criteria. And it also advocate, right, that to respect the human rights, right? And this Human Rights Watch basically works on behalf of refugees, migrants, political prisoners, or also with respect to certain NGOs also. Okay, now it has been claimed that the Israel is committing the crime of apartheid. Now, what is this crime of apartheid? Let us understand this one. See, crime of apartheid, as it is defined in 2002, the Roman Statute of International Criminal Court. So that is the International Criminal Court, the Roman Statute basically, defined what is the crime of apartheid. So it is simply an inhuman act of a character which is similar to other crimes against the humanity. So it is basically, what is the crime of apartheid? It is committed in the context of an institutionalized regime of systematic oppression and domination by a one racial group, right, over the other racial groups, which is committed with the intention of maintaining that regime. That means, very simple, you can understand that, right, the regime of Israel, which is to maintaining its own regime of the superiority, the regime had adopted the systematic oppression and the domination, right, by adopting its institutionalized, a regime of systematic crime over and above the Palestinians. And the purpose of making of this the institutionalized regime of systematic oppression of the domination is to continuing or maintaining its regime, right? So for the purpose of the maintaining of this regime, they have adopted this type of policies. Okay, now for your understanding also, in November 30, 1973, the United Nations General Assembly also, you know, opened for the International Convention on the Suppression and the Punishment of the Crime of Apartheid, right? So, which also defined the crime of apartheid is basically an inhuman act which is committed for the purpose of establishing and maintaining this dominion of one racial group over the other racial groups. Okay, so the Human Rights Watch basically in 1977 already won the Nobel Peace Prize, right? As it is basically as a founding member of international campaign to ban landmines, as well as it is also having played a leading role in 2008 treaty banning the cluster munitions specifically in the international context. And the Human Rights Watch, which is an international human rights organization, is co-founded by Robert L. Weinstein, as well as Arya Nair, right, which is a private American NGO in 1978, right? And it was initially found under the name of Helsinki Watch to monitor then Soviet Union's compliance with the Helsinki Accord. And subsequently, it was again, you know, become one of the biggest organization in the world to watch over the human rights abuses around the world. Okay, so here it is the political map of Israel and the Palestine. So if you see this map, it is basically, you know, the conflict between Israel and the Palestine, specifically for this World Bank and the Gaza Strip. This is the Gaza Strip and the World Bank, right? So here, when the Donald Trump was the president, right, before the current president, you know, the Donald Trump basically has 180 degree turn on the US foreign policy. Now, you know, the US basically, you know, have more accommodative approach, specifically the Israeli interest in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. You must also understand the two territories, West Bank and the Gaza Strip, was basically, you know, have been under Israeli occupation. It was previously a Palestinian territory, but now they are Israeli occupation since 1967. Okay. So, the West Bank, that is you are seeing here, the West Bank is basically located to the west of River Jordan. Okay. The Jordan basically forms an international boundary. So, it is a landlocked territory which is bordered by the Jordan to the east. Here you can see the Jordan which is lying to the east, right? And to the Israel to the south, right? Here you have the country called Israel, and to the west and the north also. So, this is basically bordered by the Israel from the three sides and to the Jordan from the east side. The Gaza Strip that you are seeing here, which is under, you know, the Israeli occupation, which is on the other hand, is small boot-shaped territory. It is a boot-shaped territory, okay? And it is basically along the Mediterranean coast, right? Here you have the Mediterranean Ocean, that is between Israel and the Egypt, right? Here you have another country called Egypt, and you have another country called Israel. So it is between the Israel and the Egypt, and it is basically located on the Mediterranean coast. Okay, if you want me to explain a bit about the Palestinians and Israeli dispute, I'll explain you in briefly in just 1 or 2 minutes. So first of all, let us understand the First World War. As you know, that everyone knows about First World War occurred in 1914 to 1918. Okay, now what happens is, after First World War, the Gaza Strip basically become a British mandated territory. So it has become, you know, the British mandated Palestinian. So British is basically having the authority over the Gaza Strip, right? What happens is, after World War II, right, there was a strong demand that the Jews, you know, which is started fleeing the Nazi Europe, because there was a German ruler called Hitler who have also persecuted this Nazi population, specifically in the Germany. So what happens is, this Jews population started fleeing the Europe, specifically the Germany, right? And they started fleeing for the homeland within the Palestinians, because the Jews basically considered the Palestinian land basically at their as they are also the homeland. So what happens is, right? So because of the consideration of the Jerusalem is also considered the holy place by the Muslims as well as by the Jews also for the purpose. So the Jerusalem, which is considered as a holy city by the Jews, so they started migrating towards the Palestinians because of the persecution that was adopted by the Europe, specifically by the Germany, by the German Hitler. Okay. So they started moving towards the British mandated Palestinians, right? And there was definitely a dispute between the Jews and the Arabs at that point of the time. So what happens is, in 1947, when the British mandated basically ended in Palestinian, right? So what happens is, the United Nations itself proposed that there should be a partition of Arab Jewish region or Arab Jewish Palestinian, right? So United Nations itself proposed for that. And the United Nations proposed that this partition would be between the Palestinian as well as the new state of Israel. That means the United Nations itself proposed that this region of Palestine should be divided between the Palestinian and as well as the Israel, right? So initially the division was in such a way that the 53% of the land goes to the Jews, right? That is basically, you know, for the Israel. Okay. And remaining 47% of the land basically goes to the Palestinian, right? It was initially mandated. What happens, creating this, the new Jewish territory, right? The Arab countries did not like that because they were basically the Muslim dominated region. So what happens is, the Jewish paramilitary groups were basically formed, right? That were formed by the Israel at that point of the time in 1948, when the United Nations itself divided this region into the Jewish dominated Israel as well as the Muslim dominated Palestine, right? So what happens is, there was a deadly war between the Israel one side and another side. You have, you know, there was not Israel, between the Arab neighbors. There was a deadly war between, you know, the Egypt, Iraq, Lebanon, Syria and Jordan in 1948. I'm talking 1948, right? And this was basically the first war which has followed by the Arab-Israeli war, which was basically involvement of Egypt, Iraq, Lebanon, Syria, Jordan with the Israel. So now they fought, and what happens is, the Israel won this war. This war was won by the Israel, and that basically further complicated the situation. And since 1967, the Six-Day War was there. The Israel basically, occupied this West Bank and the Gaza Strip from the Palestinians after having this war. Okay, let's move to the new news after having sufficiently discussed this news. Okay, so CT value. What is that CT value? First of all, everybody knows about RT-PCR test that is being conducted for the purpose of checking whether the person has the positive COVID-19 symptom or negative COVID-19 symptoms. Okay, so the scientific basically research has recently been says that the COVID-19 pandemic has a part of public vocabulary. That vocabulary will be in the form of CT value. The CT value is basically to ascertain whether the RT-PCR test will be showing the positive result or negative result for the purpose of the COVID-19, assertion whether the person has COVID-19 or not. Okay, so this CT value is very important for the purpose. Now, before moving to that news, let us understand what is RT-PCR first, briefly, then we'll move to the news. So RT-PCR basically stands for the reverse transcription, okay, polymerase chain reaction. Okay, so it is simple. It is a reverse transcription polymerase chain reaction. Okay, so it is simple. In RT-PCR test, what happens is, it is considered as the most accurate test for the novel coronavirus disease, as you already know. The RT-PCR test uses the nasopharyngeal swab or the oral swab or the nasal swab. So it can take the oral swab, nasal swab or the nasopharyngeal swab for the identification of the virus particles in the patients. Okay. And obviously this test is carried out by the trained professionals with the help of this RT-PCR kits. Okay. And the COVID-19 RT-PCR test basically detect the genes which are specific for the SARS-CoV-2 virus, right? So which virus which basically causes this COVID-19, the problem or disease in the humans. So it is a short cycle threshold that we call the CT value, right? This emerges during the RT-PCR test, which is basically conducted, and it is basically a gold standard for the detection of this variant of COVID-2 virus. So according to the Indian Council of Medical Research advisory, the CT value of an RT-PCR test is very much important for the purpose of detection of this virus. So it is basically the number of cycles at which the fluorescence of the PCR product is basically detected over this RT-PCR test which is being conducted. So CT values refers to the number of cycles after which the virus can be detected. For example, you have you have performed a test. Okay, the higher number of cycle if it is required, for example, for performing a test for the detection of this COVID-92 virus or the SARS-CoV-2 virus, right? If you have to perform a number of cycles, right? And if these number of cycles are more, what you can say that the frequency of the finding of the virus is less, because the number of cycle is required that is more. That means the virus is undetected, right? So the virus is undetected, right? And it implies that virus went undetected when the number of cycles are basically lower. If the higher number of cycles is basically required, and lower the CT value, that is the third point, that if that lower the CT value or number of cycles which are lower, that means it shows that there is a high viral load, right? So that means the virus have been spotted many times, right? Specifically in the lower, you know, in the lower case of cycles. So after a few cycles, the virus have been detected. So Indian Council of Medical Research advisory have given an advisory that a patient is considered COVID positive if this CT value is below 35, right? That means if the CT value is below 35 or at 35, it will be considered COVID positive, right? So if the virus is detectable after 35 cycles or earlier, then the patient is basically considered as a positive of the coronavirus, you know, symptoms. Okay, next, the Sterlite Copper Plant. Now the Sterlite Copper Plant is basically belongs to the Vedanta Limited, right? And this Sterlite Copper Plant basically is shut down since 2018 when there was a protest and 13 protesters was basically killed. Okay, so recently what happens is the Vedanta basically Limited has claimed that it can supply, you know, basically medical oxygen, right? In the background of the shortage of the medical oxygen for the patients for which the COVID-19 is basically, you know, having infected the large number of patients. So the Supreme Court recently allowed the Vedanta Limited to operate its oxygen production unit, specifically in the Sterlite Copper Plant in Tuticorin. Tuticorin is basically a district in the Tamil Nadu. So recently, the shuttered Sterlite Copper Plant have been given the, you know, green signal or green light by the Honorable Supreme Court to restart the plant for the purpose of, you know, for the purpose of production of the medical oxygen for the treatment of patient. Okay, so a brief background about the Sterlite Copper Plant. There was a protest in 2018, okay, in which the 13 protesters were killed in the police firing, right? And since then the Supreme Court basically shut down the plant, right, indefinitely for the purpose of the production of copper. Okay, so recently the Supreme Court has basically allowed that the Vedanta Limited can operate this plant for the purpose of production of this medical oxygen, which is basically required for the purpose of treatment of the patients. Okay, so let me give you what was the violence that basically led to the 13 people in 2018. So that was also called the Tuticorin massacre or Tuticorin violence. There was the protest which was taken place by the villagers specifically in 22nd, 23rd May 2018. Okay, and there was basically a copper smelter plant that was run by the Vedanta Limited, that is in the name of the Sterlite Corporation. So this copper smelting plant, basically, you know, there was a protest that this company basically is disturbing the local ecology, local environment, because the local community concerned about the hazardous industrial operation that was basically carried out by this Sterlite Corporation plant. So here the certain toxins like lead, arsenic, sulfur oxides, right, different other pollutants, right, have been just released to the environment, and that is also injurious to not only to the environment but also to the humans. And what happens is with that intention, there was a leak of a gas from this plant also in 2013. This protest was continuously going on since 1995, and there was a leak in 2013, right? And government initially ordered to immediately shutting down the plant. And what happens is the Supreme Court followed this process and put 100 crores of, you know, the fine on the Sterlite Corporation for the purpose of flouting environmental norms. But again, this Sterlite copper plant was started functioning again, and there was continuous fight for the purpose of protecting the environment, because many toxins have been released by this plant, say arsenic, lead, sulfur oxides, and different other pollutants which may be injurious to the health, to the ecosystem, to the biodiversity. And that led to the huge protest in 2018 and 13 people were killed during the police firing, and then the Supreme Court ordered to completely shut down the plant. And now recently the Supreme Court basically allowed this plant to reopen for the purpose of generation of medical oxygen in this plant. All right, so this is what is background. And here, as I told you, that the Vedanta Limited would supply, you know, around 1000 tons of the oxygen to the patients. And ever since its inception, since 1994, there was demand to shut down this plant because it was facing a huge protest against the villagers, because they were susceptible to certain toxins like arsenic, sulfur, lead, and all sort of things have been injurious to the environment as well as to the public health. Okay, and as I told you that in the March 2013 there was a leak. The state government immediately ordered the shutting down of the plant. Supreme Court basically fined this Sterlite plant for 100 crores for fine for flouting the environmental norms. And later it started functioning in the June again. And then what happens is, it again, you know, there was a protest, and what was happened, the police firing was there. 13 people died. 13 people died. And in that protest in May 2018, it was shut down completely. And then now in 2021, it has again restarted. So it is Sterlite plant. Okay, next, you have infliximab. What is infliximab? That is basically, you know, the person basically who has certain problem like inflammatory bowel disease. Okay, that a person who is taking basically anti-inflammatory bowel disease tablets, right? What happens is, the tablets or the medication basically suppress the immune system of a person. Now what happens is, if the person who takes, you know, the COVID-19 vaccine, that may not be effective, the first dose may not be effective, because the large scale study have published recently has shown that the person who is taking the drug for the inflammatory bowel disease, right, that dose of the COVID-19 vaccine may not be effective, because the anti-inflammatory bowel disease tablets or the medications basically suppress the immune system, and that suppressed immune system may not effectively allow the vaccines to perform in the human body. So that has been recently been claimed in a study, that is because of that found that this anti-inflammatory bowel disease tablets or the medications basically have led to the poor antibody response in the patient. So research basically measures the antibody response after vaccination, specifically in this the Pfizer or the AstraZeneca, which is a COVID-19 vaccine, in 865 people, that is basically which is treated with this infliximab. Infliximab is basically, you know, a drug. It is a basically drug which basically used to treat this inflammatory bowel disease, which is basically happened in the person. So that is basically prescribed to around 2 million people worldwide. Okay, so let us understand what is this inflammatory bowel disease. So inflammatory bowel disease is a basically an umbrella term, okay, which is used to describe the disorders that involve the chronic inflammation of your digestive tract. So the digestive tract have been inflamed, right, because of some sort of a infection. So there are two types of this, the inflammatory bowel disease. The first is called the ulcerative colitis, and the second is called basically Crohn's disease. So in the ulcerative colitis, right, this basically involves the inflammation and the source, that is the ulcers along the superficial lining of your large intestine, that is your colon as well as your rectum. So there will be the inflammation and the ulcers that will be there along the lining of your large intestine, that we call as the colon or your rectum. In the Crohn's disease, what happens is, there will be the inflammation of the lining of your digestive tract that will be involved in the deeper layers of your digestive tract. So both the ulcerative colitis as well as the Crohn's disease, both are basically the two types of the inflammatory bowel disease, right? In that inflammatory bowel disease, right, the drug that we'll be using is that infliximab, which is basically treated, you know, this type of inflammatory bowel disease. Now the person who is taking this drug is finding that the COVID-19 vaccine is basically, you know, has not shown any efficacy or, you know, has shown the poor body response in those persons. All right. Next, one of the brand name under which Infliximab is basically marketed is Remicade, which is also got regulatory clearance in India recently by the drug regulator of India. Okay, so this anti drug, which is being effectively treatment of this immune medicated inflammatory disease, but that drug basically, they suppress the immune system of a person, and that can reduce the vaccine effectiveness, that was I was telling, and that basically again promote the risk of the serious infections, especially those persons who are basically using this anti-inflammatory drugs. Okay, so here you have the diagram or medical diagram for the purpose of explaining this problem. Okay, next, the Pyrazole. Okay, so Pyrazole is basically an Indo-German project. That means the Indian government as well as German government both are involved in this pilot project, which is also known as the Pyrazole project, right? The purpose of the Pyrazole project is to generate the biochar for the purpose of energy recovery. Okay, so a foundation is stored for the integrated solar dryer, and the pyrolysis pilot project have been recently been laid by the director of the Center Leather Research Institute, which is located in Chennai, Dr. K.J. Sriram, right? So Dr. K.J. Sriram, who is the director of Center Leather Research Institute, have recently laid a foundation stone for the integrated solar dryer and the pyrolysis pilot, which was laid down, right, for the purpose of the project Pyrazole. Now, the institute called the Center Leather Research Institute is basically a pioneer institute, right, which is the world largest leather research institute in terms of the research paper and the patents which it publishes every year. Okay, this institute is located in the Chennai, right? If you ever been to IIT Chennai or Indian Institute of Technology Chennai, so it is located just nearby to IIT Madras. Okay, so it is a very beautiful, it has a very beautiful campus along with IIT Madras. Okay, it was founded in 1948, okay, as a constituent laboratory under the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. So it is located nearby IIT Madras. Okay, now, as I told you that it is awarded to the CSIR, the Central Council of Center Leather Research Institute, which is by the Indo-German Science and Technology Center, for the purpose of generation, for the purpose of development of this technology, for the development of this biochar. So the project will ultimately lead to the technological development for the purpose of the fibrous organic waste and the sewage sludge of the Indian smart cities, right? As you understand that there are many types of the waste which is basically generated in the cities. Like you have the organic waste, that is also known as fibrous organic waste, as well as you have the sewage waste. Now, how will you convert this organic waste into the valuable biochar? Okay, the main purpose of converting this organic waste or the sludge waste into the biochar is definitely for the purpose of energy recovery, right? The carbon sequestration as well as the environmental improvement. So we need to treat this sludge, we need to treat this organic waste, right, and to convert them into the most highly energy recoverable form, that is biochar. Okay, for the purpose of that one, this project was basically started. So what is biochar? Biochar is basically a charcoal that is produced by the pyrolysis of biomass. So here the biomass will be used from organic waste as well as from the sludge. Okay, undergone the pyrolysis, and that is in the absence of oxygen. Okay, and that will be used for the purpose of, you know, energy recovery. So the biochar is basically a stable solid that is rich in terms of carbon. Okay, and that biochar can endure the basically in the soil for thousands of the year, and that basically we can use for the energy recovery, for the carbon sequestration, as well as for environmental improvement. So here the Indo-German Science and Technology Center was established by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, as well as the Federal Ministry of Education and the Research, that is with the Government of Germany. So both Government of India as well as the Government of Germany is involved in the adoption of this Indo-German Science and Technology Center, and under which this project was also mooted. All right. So this Indo-German Science Technology Center is basically a flagship program, that is 2+2 projects, catalysis innovation centric R&D projects, by synergizing the strength of research and academic institutions of both of these countries. Right, from India and the Germany, we will involve both of these private as well as the public industries, the academians, right, for the purpose of collaboration for the development of this technology, for which we can develop, right? And we can convert the organic waste as well as sludge into the most stable biochar for the energy recovery, for the carbon sequestration, as for the purpose of environmental production, environmental protection, right? For the purpose of that one, Indo-German Science and Technology Center has mooted this program, right? With the effort of Government of India as well as with the effort of Government of Germany, all right? So I hope it is well clear. Okay, so here you can understand this project, which has been mooted with the help of the both of the scientists belong to the Government of India as well as Government of Germany. So here the Central Leather Research Institute within the campus, you can understand the scientists as well as the researchers who are just standing before this project. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this class. Be safe, right? Take care of yourself, of the corona, right? And we'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much.